Hello, welcome everyone to another episode of the Virtual Ninja Show. Today I have a special guest here, and special because we never did this before. We invited an MVP, a Microsoft Most Valuable Professional. Mattias, please introduce yourself.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's amazing to be a part of this show. My name is Mattias Borg. I work as a threat hunter at a company called OneWin. I also do a lot of blogging, and me and a close friend and a colleague just launched the defenderboys.com, which will be like the new thing, which is amazing. Otherwise, I'll be doing Defender in general since the all Windows ATP, and I've been growing together with the product.
Yes, and we know each other for such a long time. So Mattias, an MVP, and I think you are MVP for the category security, that's right?
Yeah, and also yes. Within the team XDR like subcategory, mm-hmm. and also an active member in the customer connection program, so the security community. Where I lead the advanced hunting topics. I'm a discussion topic leader there, trying to like sort out questions and stuff.
So today, and I'm super excited about this, we never did this before. So you basically brought an attack with you, and we are going through that attack and run it. And then we will see how attack disruption, one of our favorite features, from customers as well, right? So time from detect to respond super quick. How attack disruption will actually disrupt this attack? Can you explain, without going into the details yet, but what is the attack in a nutshell?
Yeah, so what we're going to focus on is the like business email compromise. So we're going to phish a regular user. And even if the user is using multi-factor, we're going to bypass that because we're using the Evil Jinx proxy. And we're also going to take some actions in when we have access to the mailbox and do some forwards and stuff.
Cool. And you wrote a blog about this as well. So for people who would like to learn more about it, see again what kind of files have been used, how can people access that?
Yeah, well, you can go to our former URL, tech-labs.com, and or the new one, defenderboys.com. So the idea with the blog post was to go into the depth of how it's working and like why we need it and so on. And I guess like on this show, we're going to talk a little bit how it works and which things you need in place for it to work as well.
Yes.
And also where it becomes much more efficient than a human being. You still need humans to do the SecOps, but this is a huge help in the day-to-day work, actually, when work with Defender and consuming the data.
Yeah. So I think let's get started on, I would divide it, how does the environment of the user look like? How does the environment of the attacker look like? And what are the resources, files that the attacker is going to use? Does it make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. What's configured here is a small version of an enterprise setup. So we have an on-prem environment with some devices, and we have a lot of users, teams, and so on are installed. So this target user is logged on and receives a chat message from the threat actor, mm-hmm. With a link. I mean, that's a common scenario. We also see attacks where they're using teams as the vector because it is an easy way to get instant access, and they can sort of get under the hood of the user by sending nice messages and so on before sending the links.
So, but before we get to that, which is already the execution of what the attacker is doing, so the attacker is also then using Teams and opens a chat with that user. When I see the name, the chat is cats, dogs. But how does the attacker's environment look like and so on?
Yeah, so the attack environment is a Linux box, which has the phishing framework Evil Jinx installed. Which act as a proxy. So when the user gets to this fake login website and tries to log in, the proxy will actually try to log in to Office 365 in this case. And when the proxy is prompted with MFA from Office 365, the proxy will then pipe that and prompt the end user with the number matching or whatever kind of MFA it is, except for like feed or two keys, and similar MFA methods, which are phishing proof.
Mm-hmm.
So when using the app and so on, we can have the proxy to send that information back to the user, and they expect that information because they're actually logging in. So what we will do then, and what we will get as a threat actor, is the authentication cookie that we can then inject into our browser and become logged in. So we can start browsing, navigating Office 365, read emails, read documents, and so on.
Scary.
Yeah, we see that. Like it's very common today. I would say like most of the phishing look like attacks that we see today, or the business email compromise, is executed in a similar way. Instead of just the credential stuffing, where they sort of try to gather as many credentials as possible, maybe for resell or whatever you want to do with it. But now they get instant access, and it's very common today. And I would say it's on a daily basis for all our MDR customers today.
Good. And then do we want to explain what are the files being used or something, like scripts that you're running, or is that's it?
Yeah, well, what I've done here is that I've installed Evil Jinx. That's being downloaded from GitHub and installed. And also configuring my custom domain. I'm currently using my demo domain, mylittlepony.com. And I configured the DNS for this domain to point to my attacking machine, to automate the TLS, or the certificate creation, and so on from Let's Encrypt. And all these functionalities are built in Evil Jinx. So the people behind Evil Jinx have done a great job in building such a tool. Unfortunately, it's being used by threat actors. So that's the challenge. So we need to know about these kind of attacks, and also both detect when it happens and respond to it. Because from a log perspective, it looks more or less like a regular user login, except for it might come from an IP where the user's never been before.
Mm-hmm. So I would say, let's hop into the demo and get started with it.
Yes, absolutely. This is a new conversation. We get this warning message. I know from experience that it's very common that user just ignores these kind of warnings and just press accept because they're curious. All right, so it feels like the person is a bit stressed because they sent the message, and then they like, hello, are you there? All right, so we have our link here. Looks like it goes to portal.office.com, but if we hover, we see that it's something else. So we will click on this.
That's what users do, right?
Yes, exactly. All right, so we are presented with a login screen. I mean, we're used to this. Let's close that one. We see that the URL is messed up. We could create something that looks even more like the Office login, like microsoftonline.com and so on, to try to push our domain as far to the right as possible. Especially if you do this from your mobile phone. I mean, there's not much room for the full URL on the mobile phone, and it's easier to trick the user. All right, so we use the bella.daniels@chief365defender.com. And we are prompted with MFA. All right, so let's approve this MFA. The number matching, and press 48, and maybe you should respond something to the threat actor. I'm here. So if we look at the threat actor's perspective now, we can see that we have a new visitor, and we can see that browser information, user agent, and which landing URL they're using. We can see the password. Well, it's not a good password, but unfortunately, this is how it looks when we do offensive assignments and do like a password hygiene in their environment. It's not very uncommon that we run into these kind of passwords. I remember one pen test we did where we actually found a tier zero or domain admin with a really, really bad password, like summer 2020 or something.
That's my regular password.
Yeah, mine too. No, I have this like star, like everyone else.
Yes.
All right, so if we look at sessions now, we can see the password. And here's the authentication cookie. So what we can do now is that we copy this cookie and go into our threat actor box. And so here's the team chat, and we go to office.com, and it asks us to sign in. And so what we do here is that we add our cookies that we retrieve from Evil Jinx.
So why is this everybody, like, why is it even being offered?
Yeah, it's community.
I know. Crazy.
Some people are developing things for, for credibility and so on. And some people develop the attacker tools to prove that something needs to change. And they share it openly. But if there is such tool available, then organizations that work with security operations or building security tools, they need to adapt to these kind of tools and make sure that they deliver tools that protect against these kind of attacks and so on.
So I see Daniel Anderson sent this file, but you are Bella.
Exactly. So we're logged on as Bella Daniels. And we used the authentication cookie that we got from Evil Jinx, and it was already MFA'd. So what we can do now is access emails.
You can do everything.
Yeah, exactly. We can access files and so on. So for instance, interesting thing as a threat actor would be searching for password.
Is MFA turned on or turned off? So I didn't see a prompt or something.
Yeah, so the MFA is already in the token. So when Bella Daniel logged into our fake login page, she approved MFA, and therefore that will be written into the token. So when we inject our cookie with all this information, we've already bypassed MFA.
Wow. So we need to make users more sensitive of, like, look where you enter it and look where you actually approve MFA. This is scary.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so we did find a password. Maybe it's something we can reuse further on in the attack. Another thing we want to do is we want to look at the rules or create a rule, because we want to extract all the emails. All right, so we want to create a new rule.
That attacker is now creating a rule.
Yes, exactly. And I mean, this can be done through code instead.
Yeah.
But I think it's more clear to do it manually, and it works as good as with code, except for it's more clicks. So what we want to do is we want to forward it to catanddogmemes@hotmail.com. Right. So what will happen now is that all the emails that is sent to Bella now will be forwarded to the threat actor. And we can also have other actions like hide the emails and so on. So remove that one. We want to steal the emails regardless if she's on the CC or in the to field.
Yeah. And then I think you need to confirm the email. Yes. Use this. Perfect.
And then we do save.
Okay. So we added one rule. And now I think you were saying you want to add another rule or something?
Yeah. So what we want to do now as a threat actor is that we want to send an internal email to the CFO and ask him to speed up the payment of an invoice, for example. And so we send an email to Daniel and urgent invoice due date. Please pay the invoice number 123456. Thanks, Bella. And we send that email. But now we don't want Bella to notice that this was actually sent. So if Daniel replies to this email, we don't want that email to end up in her inbox. So she will understand that something happened. So we will create another rule.
That everything that comes from Daniel is going into the...
Yes, exactly. Daniel... And we could also do a more granular rule to just take the replies that contains that subject or something. We can move it to drafts, just to hide it somewhere. And we also want to mark as read, so we don't add to her unread email counter. And then we do save on this one. So now we have full control of this email. So all emails will be exfiltrated to the threat actor, and all the response to this invoice thing will end up in drafts and marked as read.
So what happened in order, like, for alerts? Because in the end, Bella approved signed into a phishing page, providing her credentials, approved MFA, And then that attacker used that cookie, the token, to sign into Office. So what are some suspicious activities now?
Yeah, so if we look at every specific event, it's not very much suspicious. The only thing could be if the proxy is in a country where the organizations don't have any business. It could be like an impossible travel. So there's a lot of things that could be detected separately. There are a lot of protective measures that should be configured, both from hardening your exchange online and also in terms of conditional access from where you're allowed to log in, from which devices, and so on. But what we see out there is that not everyone has configured this.
So, but then from an attack disruption perspective, and, you know, we are talking about this business email compromise scenario, what has been detected? Let's have a look.
So we have the incident. What happened here is that it has detected all the clicking on the risk links and also the adversary in the middle, which is the Evil Jinx phishing toolkit, basically acting as a proxy, and also the like forwardings and other things we did to the account.
Which I find like super interesting. Like, you know, it's even a mailbox rule manipulation, right? So this is amazing that our tools are actually alerting on that.
Yes, exactly. And also, depending on the situation and what's actually being triggered, it will take certain actions as well. But the most important thing from a SecOps perspective is that we get information about this event happening. So even if we like take action and change the user password, revoke tokens, and so on and so forth, also being notified that the mailbox rule was added is also super important to avoid email exfiltration that goes on forever, sort of.
And I see, of course, the attack is labeled with attack disruption, right? So because attack disruption did something here. So can you tell us a little bit what attack disruption actually disrupted?
Yeah, so basically, I mean, one thing is disabling the user, and the actions taken is totally depending on what it discovered and also what it was 99% certain of, that it's something bad.
Yeah. And of course, you could now go to the Action Center. Just for everyone out there, Action Center would be where you see all the actions taken also by attack disruption, and you could revert them back in case they did something that you didn't want it to do. But this is amazing. And thank you for sharing.
Yeah, and also, I mean, reverting is super important, just so people know that they can revert something. And also, there is possibility to configure excluded accounts, for example. In general, I mean, even if it's like C-level management or something, it's super important that actions are being taken very quickly. So be cautious about exclusions in general.
Okay, thank you. So, Mattias, this is so much information. And, you know, I think awesome that you wrote the blog, and we put a link there again, because, you know, you need to digest this and understand again. So thanks for the blog, and thanks for the coming to the show. Super exciting. And I know there is way more we could talk about when it comes to attack disruption, but our time is limited here. So I, again, thank you for being my expert on today's episode. I hope everyone out there enjoyed seeing this attack and how attack disruption kicked in. And I hope I see everyone soon again. Bye.